And welcome back to Let's Play Tears of Eternity. Blind. We're headed back to the Brackenbury district. First fires. World map. Well, let's head here. You can pretty much choose anything from here anyway. So we have to head back to the Sanitarium. We have to go see this Modred guy. Sounds very mysterious. He has this other guy, Helig of Thane's Grimoire. And if we get his Grimoire back, plus I want to explore more of the Sanitarium anyway, he will help us find Rowena, who Dalton is looking for. She's the ghost of his dead lover. And I am amazed I remembered all these names. That was insane. Okay, so the Sanitarium is, well, we came in from this way. Alright, we're all the way over here. So yeah, I knew at some point we could see more of this, so hoping this will unlock more of the Sanitarium. We met two people in there. Unless if it's on the first floor. But no, down in the spooky area where you have the, it's not mapped out. A trunk in his laboratory. So I don't know if it's up here or down the second level. What is this? That's Ardmer. Random animancer. That's Nans. She helped us get that staff. Eormid. Random animancer dudes. Verna. I figured it would be down here. Now here we have the fog of war stuff. Although we've looked around here, so... It's Bellasege. Yeah. Something else you need? I'm looking for an expert on awakenings. She laughs bitterly. Ach, that would be me. Though the lack of research subjects has made me more of an expert in counting floorboards, I would like to transfer Animancy's success in buttressing pre-awakened souls to soothing those whose souls have already been awakened. But I need subjects, and most of the patients here are too broken to produce reliable results. It is a tragedy to have come so far for nothing. You're in luck. I have a volunteer, and that would be Aloth. And I was incorrect last time when I spoke of the quest that failed when he died. Of course, we restored that save, but he died and said a quest failed. It was his own quest, duh, you know, about the other personality he has inside him, or soul, as it may. She springs to the balls of her feet, beaming. Gallard! Who is it? What does that mean? Wonderful? Aloth's lips curl into a frown. I don't know about this. She grins more broadly still. Don't be silly. The process is perfectly harmless. All you must do is stand in that cage. That's what the cage is all about. I beg your pardon. You should have voiced this. I can hear it in my head. His voice. I jest. You Adarians are so uptight. I do not even know what the thing is used for. Right? It belonged to the last occupant of this office, I think. Now they upgrade him to a cell. Again, I jest. Well, there's another cage. There's a few of these in these rooms. She rubs her hands together, getting down to business. So, I need you to sit here. She takes Aloth by the shoulders and steers him to the couch. And try to relax, but don't try too hard. Then you will not be relaxing. Indeed, his eyes are humorless. And you must also wear these. A little cold, but the copper will help conduct your essence. The animancer fastens thick copper bands to Aloth's forehead and wrists. As she ratchets them together, his face twitches with suppressed irritation. Now, I will examine your soul through my scope. She reaches into her desk and produces a long chambered tube. Knobs, dials, and small toothless wheels run along the side of the device. It is fitted with Adra lenses cut to different thicknesses and concavities. By manipulating them, I find the angles and densities that will allow me to track the anomalies in your soul. You know, this would have been great if it had one of those, you know, these illustrations with the scroll, you know, when you click to continue, but you know, maybe you know what I'm talking about. Kenna says, "How exciting! I've never seen this sort of thing performed." Kenna peers at the device with interest. "It seems suitably complicated." We haven't heard from Kenna for a while. Ydir says, "Does that mean we'll get to talk to Isselmere more? I like that lady." Yeah, she's pretty interesting, huh? She raises a finger. "But first, we must find this cunning interloper. You will answer some personal questions while I make adjustments." Palagina says, "Good luck. You'd have an easier time getting straight answers out of a drunk priest of Whale." Aloth squirms on the couch. "Very well. See, we need an illustration, because he's not, clearly not on the couch. He's standing over here." Bellasege holds the scope to her eye and flicks a knob. "To begin, tell me something personal. Something from a time before your awakening." "There's nothing to tell. I was just a normal child living in the Sithwood." He looks to you. His face is set in a frown, but the rigid edges of apprehension show through nonetheless. "Talk about your parents." As you speak to Aloth, you feel your voice like a bell in your chest. It tolls softly, luring him into the mists of his own memory. Bellasege doesn't seem to notice anything, but you feel as if your words are smoothing his essence, untangling its many threads. He closes his eyes. "Mother is away most of the time, with the Thane's family, but I always know when she is coming home. Father's bottles accumulate like storm clouds on the horizon. His fits of temper become swifter and more violent. It still shames him, knowing that her... what? Hamneg to another man supports us better than his labors as a steward. I don't know that word." Bellasege says, "This is good. I am starting to see... something. Continue. Tell us about the time you awakened." She bites her tongue as she twists one of the dials. "I am in my fifth year of training. Mother is home. I can let my guard down a little, because when she is around, he is usually only angry with her. But he has heard that I have had trouble casting missiles, that my flame shields are unstable. He is furious that I have failed, and Mother's presence reminds him that he has failed too. The first blow takes me by surprise. One moment I am sweeping the kitchen, the next I am sprawled on the ground, stupidly looking at flecks of blood on the tile. His boots, glistening with fresh polish, thud across the floor. He kicks me in the stomach, and I curl up to shield my vitals. But it's pointless. Protecting one thing only leaves something else exposed." Oh, poor Aloth. "Still huddled on the ground, I retreat as fast as I can. I retreat until the vision of the kitchen and my own trembling knees is nothing but a pinprick against a field of black. His jaw locks, and his eyes twitch beneath their lids. Madico!" Bellasege furiously cranks the knobs along her scope. "He's hypnotized himself with this old memory. You've got to bring him out of it. Quickly. I almost have it." Okay, we can squeeze him by the hands. Shake him by the shoulders. Just tell him it isn't real, or we can slap him. Shake him by the shoulders. I mean, he's being beaten up, so I don't want to slap him in the middle of it. He'll probably think it's real. Shake him by the shoulders. "Aloth, you've got to wake up." Aloth's eyes snap open, but the expression you see in them isn't his. You've scuttled him off. A wilting daisy, that one. Bellasege sucks a deep breath through her teeth. That's it. I'm seeing a shift in his essence, something spreading and congealing. She glances at you over her scope. Keep talking. He seems to respond to you. What brought you here? Clacking bones and voices higher and higher, that warm molasses feeling that creeps down your gut when crisis is nigh. Pellegrino says, that's different. Bellasege says, Belfetto, whatever these words mean, we have flares of a totally distinct essence. She jots shorthand notes onto the pages next to her and turns one clicking knob of her scope. Now, try to get the two of them talking. Really, two at once? Isselmere, tell Aloth why you've awakened. Fie, he's the one needed me, hiding in his own bone bag like a turtle in its shell. Aloth's face twists in fury. I never turned it over to you. Bellasege says, good, very good. She rests from her scribbling, only to make another adjustment to her scope. I can now see two separate patterns of essence. Where he ebbs, the other flows. It's as if the awakened soul fills the spaces that he leaves empty. She prompts you with a circling of her wrist, quill still in hand. Go on. Aloth, what's this about ceding space to Isselmere? He grits his teeth painfully. I've given her nothing. She usurps me in my own body. Aye, and I lend him a pair, too. You should ask what I did at old man of his. How the last time he laid a hand on us, I broke it in three places. Aloth's head jerks to the side. That wasn't your decision. It's never been your decision. Nigh was awakening, but now I'm stuck with you. And damned if I let your ninnying drag us both through the scupper. Bellasege says, ah, very good. She lowers her scope and consults her notes. I think I've finally got something we can work with. I've tracked Isselmere's essence throughout the exchange. She had a particularly high density index during the most heated portions of their argument, and her essence seemed to localize most clearly in the lower portion of the subject's left rib cage. That's right around the spleen, which, of course, means that she is triggered by black bile. No doubt the subject's characteristic melancholy is to blame. Wow, really? So it's like a psychosomatic soul or something. Aloth blinks back at you, and in the midst of his perturbation, you're not quite sure who's looking out of his eyes. That's utter horseshit. Well, sounds like the other. Canna says, black bile, is it? They've certainly spat their share. Canna studies Aloth dubiously. It is a simpler explanation than I expected, all things considered. Bellasege glares at him. Yes, never mind my years of training. I suppose you have a better explanation? Removing his spleen? Can we do... I'm not even sure. Can you do that? Don't we need that? You're close. I think Isselmere's appearances are related to potential sources of trouble for Aloth. Bellasege carefully scratches her jaw, her gaze darting between you and Aloth. I suppose that could be true. She jots another note. I'll have to check this against other research. Aloth removes the copper bands. Well and good for you, but what does this mean for me? She frowns at her notes, tapping her cheek with a quill and making a grand show of concentration. However, you catch her stealing a glance at you over the pages. Let me read these for a sec. Huh. She did you a favor by dealing with your father, didn't she? I think she's trying to help you stand up for yourself. You may not like her methods, but you should hear her out. If you had to listen to her half as much as I do, you wouldn't say that. He scowls, but you notice something thoughtful in his frown. I've got a lot to process. Regardless, thank you for your help, Theodas. He does not look at Bellasege. What was that? Bellasege sets her notes on her desk and returns to her scope. Well, I hope this has been as useful to you as it has been to me. I finally have material worth publishing. You'll be the toast of Revoa, Fentre Aloth. His grimace melts into a crooked smile. Aye, advancing the right wise principles of animancy. Just what you've always wanted. As you turn to leave, you catch a darting movement out of the corner of your eye. Bellasege is humming to herself, still occupied with her scope, but Aloth is holding her notes. He's just about to tuck them into his cloak when he catches you watching. He holds a finger to his lips, his eyes wide and imploring. Please, I don't want my personal information published like this, especially not after her nonsense. Can't he, she hear that? Well, he wasn't really for this. That's a no. That's a no. Fair enough, but do it quietly. He hides the papers in his cloak. Nigh to worry. We'll see to this on our own. Sientir, but I am busy. I seem to have misplaced my notes. Huh? Something like that. Ooh, something going on at the stronghold. Minor adventure rewards minor item. Okay, so she got to escort the drunk home. Let's let, the hell is her name? Our ranger, whose name begins with S. Sanagan? Something like that. I don't know. Sagani. We'll let her do it. Taxes collected, lost 15 copper to bandits, earned 130 copper. Alright. Is this dude in here? It is! It's Modrad. Let's just slow down a little bit. I find it weird for us to walk so fast.
How do you do?
Modrad looks up from his scroll. Yes? I'll start off with... I'm just going to say I'm looking for an expert on awakenings. Just see what he says. I hear that Valian woman studies them. You should go talk to her instead. Does the name Helig mean anything to you? Modred starts, Helig? He is, a colleague of mine. He was primarily a necromancer, but he was involved in animancy too. He worked at the sanitarium for several years. I dare say everyone here has heard of him. He left his post recently. I believe he was seeking new opportunities in the Valian Republics. He leans forward. The advances they're making in animancy are really quite remarkable. Surely you've heard. Perhaps you haven't. Let's cut right to the chase. Do you know a woman named Rowena? No. I don't get out of the sanitarium much. About Helig. Modred smooths his robes. As I said, he no longer works here. I've heard it differently. He slides his spectacles down his nose. Just what are you insinuating? If this is your idea of a joke, I assure you it's in very poor taste. Huh! Number three, should I? Yeah. So you didn't sink a hole. Sorry. So you didn't sink a blade into his chest and dump him in the catacombs. I'm tired, guys. He'll be relieved to hear it. Modred pales. How could? He signs and runs a hand over his hair. I can't speak, my God. Very well. Yes, I killed him. I killed that beast because nobody else had the spine for it. He was a madman. Years of perverse experiments, twisting healthy souls, torturing damaged souls. And for what? He flayed the essence from Glamfellen indigents for his amusement. He waves down the hall. If the public had known half of his deeds, they'd have razed this place to the ground. He jabs his finger on the desk. He used the sanitarium to disguise his own sick proclivities. He brought shame on all of us and put the entire discipline at risk. I regret nothing. He calms down and sizes you up. Anyway, now you know the whole grisly story. I kind of want to get to these other things, but I'm afraid if I choose them, I won't be able to get back to the Grimoire business. Helig said you stole a grimoire from him. Modred's brow furrows. His grimoire? What's that madman been telling you? Give him the key. He said you kept it in that trunk over there. Modred takes the key with a trembling hand, his eyes darting to the trunk behind you. You've been misled. There's no grimoire here, and Helig never intended you to find one. That wretched thing has an insatiable hunger for blood, he shudders. Thank you for denying him. I hope I can convince you now to return and slay him once and for all. I wanted to get the grimoire. I figured giving him the key would be evidence. He has something I need. I don't know what he's promised you, but he's already lied to you about the grimoire. I don't have it. If what I've told you about that evil, deceitful man hasn't swayed you, I don't know what else to say. He turns back to his papers. Trust him at your own peril.
How do you do?
So you killed him to save your own reputation? Modred snorts. The reputation of the whole discipline, rather. You realize there are groups in this city looking for an excuse to have us all hanged. He shakes his head. I won't see the knowledge we've worked so hard for lost because of one man's madness. I've seen that already. Hardly brave, stabbing a man in his sleep. Brave enough for my tastes. I heard a rumor he once laid a 50-man squad to rest on his own. At least I did something. Helig's soul returned to his corpse through sinister magic. He wants revenge. No doubt. He spreads his hand wide. But now you understand why I killed him. Why someone had to. If he sent you, I only hope I can convince you to return and slay him once and for all. I want to get in the damn thing. I'll consider it. Consider also the kind of man he is and the kinds of things he's capable of. Don't trust him. I must return to my work. I wish you well. Modred returns back to his papers.
How do you do?
I'm gonna save the game. I'm gonna open the damn trunk. Or try to anyway. We were down here before. I don't know if we tried to open it. Can't believe we're up to episode 97, guys. Oh my god. In a corner of Mildred's lab rests a large weathered trunk. It seems likely to contain something important, if only by virtue of its size. Now, he said that he didn't have any grimoire, but neither did he open the trunk and to show us that there's not one in there. Examine it more closely. Nothing grabs your attention except for the large padlock on the front. Whatever this animancer keeps in here does not want anyone else to have or see. A heavy lock holds the trunk shut. It's too sturdy to break, and the mechanism looks too complicated to pick. You'll need to find the key. Damn it. And we had it, damn it. Crap. I remember right, this one's empty. Never thought I'd be taking orders from a talking statue. Alright, let's head back down to the catacombs then.
Bring back the feisty one. There's a woman can do some damage squeezing her legs together.
It isn't a parlor trick. Besides, she doesn't take orders well.
She has backbone, that woman. Does it scare you?
No, but I won't be responsible for what happens if you call her whore.
Awesome. It's like we've gained another character in our group. I like it. Kind of wondering if we, you know, should hold on to her for a while. Getting rid of her quickly might get rid of some comedic value. So, did you find my grimoire? I spoke to Mildred. He doesn't have your grimoire. Helig lets out a bubbling hiss of frustration. There's not much fun in a joke if you have to explain it, is there? What? He tugs a few hairs out of his beard. If you can't fulfill my need for vengeance, then you'll have to serve another purpose. A dried and shriveled tongue darts over his cracked lips. I'm afraid a fierce hunger was awakened along with me. Okay. Well, we could have just chose to kill you, but you're choosing for us. And, Durance should be back here. Durance should be back here. Amplified thrust. Adair. Who will do his knockdown thing here. Aloth will try to get back a little bit more. He has to wait for combat to start. Boom. Boom. Boomsty boom.
What?
Well, it just about gets us all. Fireball. We killed him already. We killed him already. That's awesome. These guys are easy. Takes care of that.
No problem.
That was easy as hell. Fine scepter. Helig's grimoire, right here. Fine robe. A soul word amulet. This brilliant bloodstone amulet has a strange aura about it. As you hold the gem, you think you hear a woman's voice. Plus 5 will. A woman's voice. Huh. Ooh. Speaking of a woman's voice, a soul prowls within the bloodstone like a caged stelgare. It's filled with a fierce, restless energy. Who are you? You see an image in your mind of a woman in heavy leather armor, bearing twin daggers. Next to her is a man, young and handsome, who calls her Rowena. Well, we found her. The vision shifts to a windswept plain next to a lake. 50 men and women in matching leathers lay dead, their bodies contorted and deformed by some sinister sorcery. Rowena falls among them, her body collapsing next to the young man you saw earlier. She's too weak to speak, but the name Dalton appears in your mind. A lone figure strides across the battlefield, barely bothering to step over the corpses. His eyes are filled with an unnatural light and fixed on Rowena. He reaches out to her, and what little life remained in her body departs. When he takes the amulet from around her neck, you feel her anguished soul trapped within it. With a final contemptuous glance at the fallen Dalton, the man departs. Dalton sent me to find you. The soul pulses with warmth. Aww. It fills your mind with memories of a young man who's both bold and generous. But fury and despair gnaw those images away until all you can feel are cold crimson walls pressing against you and something loathsome feeding off of you as the years fade into decades. What do you want? Don't ever ask that question. You see an image of an amulet shattering and the soul inside rising and dissipating among the stars. Farewell. Shall we break the amulet? Giving the amulet to Dalton would likely bring him comfort, although at Rowena's expense, I doubt she's enjoyed being held prisoner in it for so many years. Can I break it? Do I have an option? Who has it? Where's this amulet? Is it in the stash under quest items? I can't do anything with it. I mean, if there's an option to break it, I don't know how to get it out of... I can't move stuff out of the stash. Quest items. Alright. Dust and cobwebs have been swept aside for various alchemical implements, though coated with rust and grit, they look recently used. A grim assortment of rusty blades adorns this table.
Yeah.
I think I looked at this stuff already. Tarnished locket. The silver locket is dented and tarnished. A faded portrait of a young nobleman still rests inside. His face has been worn away by time. Can we give him that lock instead? I don't know. The scattered feverish notes detail various animantic procedures and rites of necromancy. Alright, well, we're done in here.
Hey.
Well, that's close. Okay. Dalton should be over here. His tired eyes brighten. Did you find her? Show him the amulet. Yes, but not as you expected. The old man studies the amulet. Rowena used to wear this. Where did you get it? Yep. Second choice. From Helig, who's kept her soul trapped inside it for decades. It's time to set her free. Dalton's eyes widen in horror. No, please, after searching for her so long. He gazes at the amulet. Just to have her close to me, to visit her in my dreams, that would be enough. We'll use our intellect. Enough for you, but what about her? If you'd keep her trapped in this amulet for the sake of your own comfort, you're no better than the wizard who imprisoned her. Dalton's expression withers. You're right. Please, let me do it. He draws a club from a trembling hand and crushes the amulet. As the gem cracks, you feel essence rush from it. Oh, we needed a cool sound effect there. The old man looks at the shattered gemstone. Thank you for showing me reason. Perhaps she'll wait for me in the next life. He looks at his hands, shaking. By the flame, she won't have to wait long. Please, take this. He hands you the club. It's from my old adventuring days. I think it's time I finally let them go. We gain an item. Dial Ewan Debita? Can't we just call it a club? Unique club, one-handed. Fast speed. Interrupt, point 35. 12 to 17 crush versus deflection. Plus 5 accuracy. Plus 4 accuracy. And plus 15% damage. Does that stack together? 5 and 4? So it's plus 9. Plus 20 damage against prone, stunned, and flanked enemies. Once owned by the Glamfellen barbarian Badrin Kawilda, this club has ended the life of many an opponent. Badrin was known to rush headlong into every battle, swinging the club over his head, shouting that stuff which says vengeance, just and merciless. Translated. Even in victory, Badrin was relentless, using the club to dispatch wounded or captive foes where they lay. In time, his battle cry came to be associated with the weapon itself, remembered long after Badrin's death. Okay, we'll probably sell this. I don't know who uses clubs. Pretty cool item, though. Thank you. My Rowena and I can finally have peace. All right, excellent. So I have to check my quest log. I'll do that off screen. See if we have to do anything else. I think there might be one other thing we have to do. Okay, this guy's freaking out. Doing a shimmy dance. Shimmy, shimmy. Shimmy, shimmy, shimmy. And he's done. And other than that, we'll head on to Heritage Hill, finally. A land of zombies and such, apparently. But I have to check my quest log. I think we have an odd thing or two to do. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.